We're here in Atlanta, and we just caught up with Christopher Rice on his book tour for his new book, The Heavens Rise. And he's been touring around town doing some drive-by signings, and now he's here with us. Welcome to Atlanta, Chris.
Thank you. It's good to be here. I like that we call them drive-by signings. It makes them sound criminal.
Well, speaking of criminal, there is a little bit of a criminal element in your latest book, The Heavens Rise. You care to tell us about that a little bit?
Well, there are a lot of supernatural psychopaths, I think, is what there are. There's one in particular. But yeah, it's a book about, it's just one of those books about a parasite that gives you the ability to control minds if you're exposed to it. You know, it's just another parasite mind control book, as we call them. I did write mysteries and thrillers previously, and this is my first supernatural book. And it's an exciting opportunity also to write about New Orleans again. I haven't written about New Orleans since my first novel, A Density of Souls. I knew I wanted to do that before I knew I wanted to do something supernatural. And in coming up with the characters for this book, I came up with a character who had this supernatural gift that I've always wanted to toy with. So,
and this was kind of loosely based on or inspired by a true incident that happened in the New Orleans area, correct?
It was. I was at a dinner party with another in LA, where I live, with another a high school classmate of mine, and we were talking about the Bright Field accident, which nobody at the dinner party had ever heard of. In fact, I've been talking about it on tour, and apparently nobody's heard of it, but I think because nobody died, and that's a good thing. But a large cargo container ship lost engine power as it was rounding the bend in the Mississippi River, and it plowed into the Riverwalk shopping mall. And a couple days after I was at this dinner party, I went home to see what TiVo had recorded for me. And it had recorded a special about the Bright Field accident. So I was like, okay, universe. So I knew I was going to write about that even before I knew I was going to do something supernatural. And I can't say too much about how that plays a role because it gets to be a little spoilery. But the world of the local riverboat pilots in New Orleans is what I really decided to commit to early on in terms of research.
Right. We wouldn't want you to give away the storyline. But I think the universe might be talking to you again, because just yesterday the main news story that I saw out of New Orleans was that another ship called the Kristen Alexis, I believe it was overturned in the Mississippi River, and they're trying to rescue whoever was involved.
I totally missed this story. I've been on the road. I've been catching 6 a.m. flights every day, but when I leave here, I will look it up right away. Listen, the river is a very complicated thing there, and the issue of the riverboat pilots is very complicated. It's one of the reasons I knew I wanted to write about it. They're paid a lot of money. They're paid $300,000 a year on average. They have intense lobbying power in Baton Rouge, but what they do is very important, and I don't actually believe they're overpaid. I think they're piloting some really dangerous material through the center of a very populated area, and I think we want local, experienced people doing that.
I would agree with you. Now, there is an Atlanta connection in your book also. Marshall is hospitalized. I guess he's the main suspect in the disappearance of this family, and he's hospitalized in Atlanta Hospital, correct?
He's taken to Atlanta by his family after Katrina when they leave. He comes from a very wealthy family. I like to write about Atlanta when I can, because growing up in New Orleans, I always felt like Atlanta was the older, prettier sister that got her act together and went to school and just figured it out, and we were like the little brother who was still drinking too hard well into his 30s. So I love Atlanta, but I have a sort of jealousy relationship with the city. But yeah, also there's an area that's not too far from here that's a barrier island off the coast of Florida and Georgia called Cumberland Island, and I have a fictional version of that in my book. It's Chamberlain Island in my book. So this whole region is very much the area of the country that I'm focused on now in my books. I said a couple books in California, and now I've gone home again.
Now, I understand that this is your first supernatural thriller, but from what I've read, the next book you're working on, it also has some supernatural content.
It is. I am one third of the way through another supernatural thriller set in the Deep South, and that's all I'm free to say at this point in time.
Except for the fact that you have hinted that it might be Birmingham.
No, it's not Birmingham. Oh, you got me to say something about it. That was very clever. It's not Birmingham. Although my affection for Birmingham does stem in large part from the fact that Robert McCammon lives there, and he's one of my favorite writers of all time.
So in the book, the main character is Niquette, and she has a fear of snakes. Is there some sexual overtone in that, or was that just a convenient
fear? You know, I hate snakes so much I can't even really psychoanalyze them. I used to think that when I was younger, that maybe it was repressed sexuality, and maybe when I was closeted, the snake represented, oh, who cares? Snakes are terrifying. Listen, I deal with more snakes in California than I ever had to in Louisiana, but because I didn't go to the swamp that often. But this book is set heavily in the swamps on the north shore of Lake Pontchartrain, and that sort of coastal areas. So it's crawling with water moccasins, right. You know, and I had to learn as much as I could about snakes to write the book. I will say this is not a horror novel about snakes killing people. There is a scene in which a snake is used by a human for a very nefarious purpose, and that's all I'm going to say.
Right.
Yeah.
And there are also scenes, I understand, of animal heads exploding.
There are. This is a scary book. This is a scary book. I don't know if I'd... Whether or not it's a horror novel depends on how you define horror novels personally. The official term is supernatural thriller. But I think that, you know, get ready. Read it with the lights on.
Yeah, and I've heard it's very difficult to put down. I haven't quite finished it yet, but a number of people I know who have had a copy for a little longer have said they just couldn't put it down and they were staying up at night reading it.
Excellent.
So
I love hearing that.
It's definitely a good time.
We had thought about making it out of glue so that you couldn't put it down, but apparently we don't have to, so good.
Now, when I first met you 10-plus years ago, you were just getting your first book out. You were kind of new to the whole touring scene. You were on the road. You were, you know, 21-ish. Mm-hmm. And
21 adjacent, yeah.
And you'd made the comment that a lot of your fan base at that point was largely younger gay people, mm-hmm. Probably because of the fact that it was widely known that you were a gay author at that time. How has that changed now that you've gotten 6 books out and the topics vary and the content is different? Have you seen a difference in your fan base?
Well, those gay people got older. Including this gay person. So there's that. I think they stuck with me, which was good, because there was that fear that, you know, you can only speak to people when they're at one sort of period of their lives. More women came on board. With this book, it feels like a lot more women are coming up in line and saying that they bought it and that this is the first book they're trying. So, you know, it's interesting. I have had an interesting career in that I didn't set out to write the same book every time, which is what somebody usually does when they have a success early on. Well, let's just repeat it. I wrote books with gay villains and gay heroes. I wrote books that were hard-boiled and noir and books that were sort of more romantic. So I like not being pigeonholed, and I like that this book seems to be reaching a different cross-section of people.
Do you see yourself at some point maybe developing a series? I know, you know, the first gay author that I met publicly was Armistead Maupin, mm-hmm. and he built his fame and fortune basically on a single group of characters that evolve through a series of
right.
novels.
Yeah.
Do you see yourself ever getting into that, into strongly developing a line of characters that repeat in 4 or 5 books?
I would love to do that. I would love to do that. I very much. And I'm not. I don't want to give anything away about this book and how it ends. But I think the potential has been there with a lot of my books. I think it's just a question of what idea is burning me up to write about next, and is it an idea that works with those characters or not? But I definitely feel that the story of these characters, well, this book definitely has a conclusion that I hope is gratifying, that's designed to be gratifying. I'm not done with these characters yet. I will say that.
Good. We'll look forward to seeing more of them. Now, on a slightly different topic, although related to your books, I've been following a lot of your posts online, and I notice on social media you go to almost any extreme to promote your book or your show or whatever's going on. You've mentioned Honey Boo Boo. You've mentioned all kinds of people. What is the most extreme thing that you've done on social media to promote a book or a tour or something that you're working on?
Probably the most extreme thing that I did was when I first started on Twitter. I didn't really have a lot of followers. I still have a lot more followers on Facebook than I do on Twitter, because my Facebook profile, while it's not a fan page, it's public. And so everything I post there is visible, even if you're not. I can't add any more friends. It won't let me. I would if I could. The most extreme thing was on Twitter, where I said I would post a picture of myself if I reached, I think it was about 1,000 followers. I would post a picture of myself. I can't remember how I worded it, but it was very cleverly worded to make you think it would be a nude picture. But I think I just said without pants or shirt or something. And so when the time came, it was me in a sundress. And I don't know if that picture, I guess it's still around there. So I posted the picture of me in a sundress. I ordered a sundress from the internet for like $15, and I did a big pose in my office. That was the most extreme thing. But listen, you know, the reality for authors right now is that all they tell us at traditional publishing houses is that we have to market ourselves on social media. You have to market yourself on social media. So I'm not really able to do that without having a sense of humor about it. So I call it snarketing. That's right. The hashtag I give it. It's snark, and that actually was not my invention. Somebody on Facebook, I don't remember exactly who, but I should give them credit, came up with that. And so I try to be clever, and people, you know, so far I have not had anybody send me some ugly post saying, stop marketing yourself. I think because I've coded it in stuff that's actually amusing to read. And if you don't like it, just block it. It's social media. Like, people's attitudes on social media, it's like, there's no federal law requiring you to follow me. Like, go away if you don't like what I'm posting.
Exactly. I remember it was about a month or maybe 6 weeks ago when you were posting that commentary about what should I call this, and people signing in with all the, with the snarketing and all these other comments. So if anybody is really adventurous out there, you can just scour through like Chris's post from maybe 4 to 6 weeks ago and see if you can find it yourself. And then you can send a message to the person who who suggested it.
We'll give them a free book.
Now, online, you also refer to this person who sometimes travels with you on book tours as that Ann lady.
Yes.
How does she refer to you?
I don't know. You know, I try to throw her a little support whenever I can because she clearly needs my help. But she refers to me as I'm trying to think what her nicknames were for me when I was a kid. She used to call me Little Wheatfield because I had crazy blonde hair that was like wheat. She would run her hands through it and call me Little Wheatfield. And then my father called me Cray Pig because I couldn't say Chris when I was little, and I was 10 pounds when I was born. I feel like I'm just the same 10 pounds. I've just stretched out over the years. This has been great. You know, here in Atlanta, I'm flying solo. Actually, yesterday in Fort Walton Beach, I did an event by myself at a store I used to go to when I was a kid. And tonight in Atlanta, I will be by myself. And then I join her in New Orleans for a series of events this weekend. But, like, her fans are really nice. They're really nice. We did a signing in Lexington, Kentucky with just the nicest people who were so grateful to have her, and it goes on for a long time. And let me tell you something, the first night, I had never done an Anne Rice signing with Anne Rice where I couldn't leave the table. I miscalculated my Diet Coke intake, and I had to stop the signing to go to the bathroom because the good news is that enough people were actually buying my book too that it would have been a loss if I hadn't stopped the signing. But I had to run, this was at Barnes & Noble Union Square, I had to run down the escalator, use the bathroom, and run back up, and people applauded sarcastically, I believe, when I finally joined the table again and started it up.
So you mentioned Diet Coke, and of course you know you're in Atlanta, which is the home of Coca-Cola.
I keep forgetting that. Yeah.
Yes, it is. And in addition to that, I've heard you talk about Nutella and donuts and all these. Are you looking for a sponsorship from one of these?
I am. I would love a sponsorship from either Krispy Kreme or Nutella. I did say recently on my internet radio show, The Dinner Party Show, which I do with my best friend Eric Shaw Quinn, that I didn't care what the CEO of Krispy Kreme did. I really didn't. He could say, I want all gay people to be sent to another country, I'm still going to eat those donuts. I'm sorry. I'll be able to boycott a lot of different products, but not Krispy Kreme. I'm just not going to be able to give it up.
Now that you've delved into supernatural thrillers, did that Ann lady help you at all with any of the idea development or anything on this book? Did she give you any guidance or support?
I'll tell you, this is the first book I gave to her and asked her to give me notes on. And it was a challenging experience because not only was she my mother, she is that Ann lady. And I had to read the notes from a healthy perspective and not act like I was in school or being punished. But she had some very valuable things to say, as did my best friend Eric Shaw Quinn, as did a lot of people that I gave it to for early reads. This was the first book I had written in a while on spec, as they say in Hollywood, which is I wrote it without talking over the idea to anybody in publishing, without letting anybody in publishing know what I was doing, including my agent. And so I needed a really close circle of personal critics. And that was my mother, that was Eric Shaw Quinn, a really good comic writer named Mark Andrako, Greg Hurwitz, a good friend of mine. All of them read the book in its early stages and gave really valuable input. And I rewrote it based on that feedback. And she was in the mix for the first time, you know, which was, it was interesting. It was good. It was good for the book.
Well, I'm sure it was, and it's good for this tour because obviously some of her fans may be a little bit of a crossover now that you have a similar concept. People that are into the supernatural, into vampires, into all of her her writing may actually cross over and read one of your books that haven't done it before.
Well, I'm hearing that a lot. There are a lot of young women coming up in line saying, I haven't read you before, and this is the first book that I'm going to read, and I hey, good. It's great.
Well, it's always good to attract a new audience. Now, in your book, several of the characters have either supernatural or superhuman powers. If you could choose one for yourself, what would it be?
Flight. I've always wanted to fly. Always.
Do you fly here?
Yeah, but in a Delta Airlines. Not in a Delta Airlines jet. It's 6 in the morning, mind you. My second 6 a.m. departure. I wanted to be able to just leap into the air and fly. I just think that's the coolest thing ever.
That would be pretty cool. Yeah. Well, we appreciate you coming out here and talking to us for a little bit and wish you the best of luck with your new book.
Thank you.
And look forward to the next one as well.
Absolutely.
Enjoy Atlanta.
I will. I always do.